Listen up. Here we go.
Rap Radar Podcast.
Yep.
B-Dot, we got a special guest, man. Yo, Corson was funny. The engineer, he said, you know, because like a lot of times we get artists and they run late and you got to give names to the front desk for their crews, their posses. He's like, I love the executives. They come early and they come by themselves.
Yep. Absolutely.
Stephen Hill is here, baby. B-T.
Yo, I am very...
The legendary executive.
I feel bad for y'all. Y'all have got to, over the next period of time, make me sound interesting.
Come on.
That's your challenge. That's the way it is.
Nah, man. Come on. Congratulations on the order. The main reason we wanted to reach out off the rip was... this new edition thing, man.
Oh, yeah.
You took over culture, baby. You know, Ronnie, Bobby, Ricky, Mike, Ralph, and Johnny, and Brooke Payne get a lot of credit, but what about Stephen Hill, man? Nah. He brought this shit on motherfucking television.
Word.
Man, it was great.
As the great star would say, applaud that man.
Applaud that man. Yo, it was really wonderful to see them finally get their due. Like people underestimate what New Edition meant to the culture. Mm-hmm. There was no social media back then, so you couldn't really get, you know, but their concerts were sold out, but they overshadowed by other groups who were of a different hue who came after them, mm-hmm. and around them. But New Edition, like, they have songs that, You know, it gets about, 1:30, 2 o'clock in the morning, the bubbly's going, they played in the club and like, Candy Girl's on!
Right?
And it takes off. And so it was great to be able to tell their legacy.
I was going to say that. Like, I felt like people underestimated how big it was going to be, right? Like, did you feel that?
Yes. Everyone doubted how big this was going to be. Mm. Some people inside the building doubted how big it was going to be. But there's a certain energy that happens with especially young girls, like 12 years old to 16. And if you can capture their hearts, like as a boy group, at that age, that energy stays with the people for the rest of their lives, right? Mm-hmm. That's why Backstreet Boys haven't had a hit in 20 years, and yet they're selling out arenas. Mm-hmm. New Kids on the Block sell out arenas. Yeah. If NSYNC ever got together, they'd sell out arenas.
Yeah, Justin could just take them and do something on the side. Right. And make
is it because of, is it a black and white thing?
Dude, the Jacksons, no, because the Jacksons, even without Michael, can sell out decent-sized theaters now because, and New Edition, you know, they're easily doing Radio City Music Hall. They're easily doing I used to call Mike. Is it Microsoft Theater now in LA still?
Oh man, what is it called now?
Who is Nokia? Microsoft. Nokia. Okay, so it's not just a white thing. Mm. It's a if you are a boy group and you can make girls scream between the ages of 12 and 16, they will show up for you when they are 40 and 50 years old.
Were you surprised how the movie impacted the new generation?
Yes. Yes. Well, so we were hoping, and we built it though so it would be family viewing, right? Mm. We hope people the they would bring their kids and their 12-year-old kids who initially would, I don't want to watch something with you, and then the cast, right? But then they see kids who look like them, right? The youngs, and it was casted so beautiful. Shout to Robbie Reed, who casted the heck out of this, right? And so you saw the littles who looked like them.
And little Bobby Brown was scary,
right? Yo, Bobby has there's a book about Bobby Brown where he has a cover, and that dude looks just like Tyler. Tyler Williams, the guy who played Bobby Brown, looks just. Why do I have this hat on, man?
It's all good. Get loose, Steven. Get comfortable, man.
What is that about? They saw the littles and they saw themselves. And so I've gotten countless emails from people who said, like, yeah, I sat down and watched this with my son or my daughter, and my daughter got caught up in one of the guys in the group, and the guy, and now my son is in the mirror practicing dance steps.
Wow. So it's almost in a sense reintroducing the boy band phenomenon, right? Because this kind of was a dying art, right, Stephen? Mm-hmm.
Anybody who's ever worked with me in music knows that my desire always is to have the boy band, mm-hmm. right? The last big one. Who do you think the last big boy band
in black music?
Yeah,
Drew Hill.
112.
Drew Hill era. 90s, right?
B2K.
Oh, B2K.
Yeah.
My bad.
Like, Mario. I'm like, yeah, B2K. Yeah. Who had that? Like, right. Oh my God! Yeah, and yeah. Girls are screaming. And y'all, we had 106. Mario, yeah. I never forget 106 in Park. They came through like when they were at their height, and we were actually up at 106 in Park at the time in that studio, and it was. Cars couldn't drive down the street because there were young girls surrounded.
Shut the city down.
Shut them down, and they were screaming, and they were, it was ornery. The best way I can put it is I saw a 14-year-old girl get put into a police car in handcuffs. and she deserved it.
Wow.
Steven was like, no lawsuits, baby.
No, she deserved it. No, I mean, they were out of their mind, but that's the thing. That energy, you can't recreate.
Yeah.
And so I'm hoping that, you know, this sparks a new boy group because there's nothing. Look, the Jackson 5 is... To me, the Jackson 5 took, the same way the Beatles took the country's mind off of JFK's assassination. In a lot of ways, the Jackson 5 came along and captured everybody's hearts and minds and took people's minds off the MLK.
MLK's assassination. Yeah,
right. And so, I mean, obviously, I don't want that to be assassination, but it's that energy of capturing the culture that is just so missing, and we haven't had it since B2K.
And how did you get involved in the business of this? Because I remember I talked a little bit to Mike Bivens, just the process of getting everybody to sign off in their lives. Mr. Bobby Brown took his time. How involved were you from the beginning with this, and like how did you get involved?
Extremely. Look, this started coming together the day after the 25th anniversary for BET, which happened October 26, 2005. And Jesse Collins, who's the executive producer of this, and Mike got on the phone like, yo, they should really tell the story.
Yeah.
And they had been developing and had worked on some scripts. And then
this is 2005.
Oh, wow. Separately, I didn't know about that conversation. Separately, as 106 and Park was kind of not coming to its end, but like we saw the future and like, okay, if we want to stay in music, we've got to find a way to contextualize music differently than playing music videos. Mm. So we started looking at different stories we could tell in music. And one of the ones that hit my mind was like, oh, the New Edition story would be a great story. Because I knew those cats from Boston. They were in Boston.
Yeah, Boston Radio.
I was at WILD in Boston. So, you know, daytime radio.
So you did the radio voice real quick, beat out.
Oh, come on. I'm gonna throw that on every once in a while. It's just going to come in. And so I was like, oh, I know this story. And if they're willing to tell their whole story, it'll be great.
Steve was like, give me the drama.
Yeah, absolutely. And so Jesse, who's been our executive producer for the BET Awards and BET Honors and Hip Hop Awards for years, we got together and we had a couple of false starts. That's the best way to put it. We had a couple of false starts. But about a little over two years ago, it was, you know, I took on a different role at BET, and literally one of my first calls was like, we are going to get this done. Mm-hmm. We are going to get that done.
Wow. One more thing on New Edition, man. Yeah. Those damn commercials, man. Jesus Christ,
word.
Steven.
There was a lot of commercials.
The phone was blowing up, right? Everybody wanted it, right?
So I'm going to keep it real. That was messed up. It was. Especially night two. I won't go into details, but here's the best way to put it. Night two was messed up. We fixed it by night three, right? Yeah. So I'm on Twitter. I'm listening.
On
Facebook.
It must have been coming at you, right?
Oh yeah. We were getting killed, and rightfully so. I admit it because we just structured the commercial breaks and the number of them. How we ran
it's
the commercial wrong. Yeah. We were able to fix it. Shout out to the programming team who got it done literally in less than 24 hours to fix night three. So we didn't get that at all.
Wow. How much did the movie cost? Because it looked really expensive.
You don't want to know the money.
Good. No, it was expensive.
Right.
We didn't cut that many quarters. Wow. We really didn't. We wanted to tell the story. We wanted to have the costuming right. We wanted to make sure the music was right. I don't know if you caught this, but Babyface produced all the music that the little kids did.
Crazy.
And Jam and Lewis actually recreated and produced the vocals of the actors of the bigs.
Wow.
That was really the little kids actors singing, and that was really the big folks singing. Now, let's be clear. When you got Luke James, it's kind of a cheat. Like, right. he can blow.
You need a cheat.
He can blow.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, he did Johnny Gill justice by doing that.
But isn't that kind of your claim to fame that people ask, well, how do you have these BET Hip Hop Awards and like and this type of thing? Because you, at the forefront, was willing to really treat the culture with respect and fight to spend the money.
Yeah, absolutely.
It the right way.
Absolutely. I take pride in the fact that we spend more money on these shows making hip hop culture look as the best we possibly can. Mm. Right? We spend a lot of money on these shows. Because it's important to show the culture in the light, at least give them the opportunity, give the culture the opportunity to be seen how it wants to be seen. Yeah. Like some people just want to get on stage with a mic and a couple of lights, and if that's what you want to do, we want to make sure that happens. But if you want flames and pyro, and if that's what you want to get your message across, we want to facilitate that.
Rappers
too.
Love the pyro. Come on.
Yeah, rappers love the pyro and the godlight.
Right.
That big blast of light that comes out from behind you and puts you in silhouette.
But for the people that don't know, your exact title of BET, and you've been there since what, 99, right?
Yeah, I've been this last since the last century. That's what I call that. I've been there since the last century.
No, but you, but again, you were the one who kind of brought the company, because it was a DC based company, right? And you was like, we're going into New York, we're taking shit over, and we're just gonna take over the game.
Yeah,
right?
In 99, we were all, everything was in DC. There was a bit of action we were doing in Los Angeles, but I'd been at MTV in New York. And as soon as I got to D.C., I realized, like, people, you know, shout out to everybody who came down to D.C. and to that place there. But it's tough because you got to take, like, a whole 2 days, a travel day, and then you get down there, you do stuff in D.C., and then
come now,
back.
Like, I know about it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So we knew if we wanted to play really seriously in the game, and that was the point, that we had to move to New York. Thank you to Bob Johnson and Deborah Lee. I thought it would take like 2 or 3 years to get that across. They were like, got it, understood. Mm-hmm. And so by September of 2000, we were starting 106 and Park.
Wow. How has your role changed in this digital space?
We don't have enough time for that, right?
Number one, all video there's so little video consumption on television now, right? Mm-hmm. Back then, it was like if you want to see the new Nelly video, you got to watch it at 6 o'clock.
Right
now, there's none of that. All the music consumption is there, but mostly for us right now, we've got a lot of great original content. Like we have New Edition Story, Madiba, The Quad with Anika Noni Rose, and so what we want to do is make sure that we can be wherever people want to view it, right? If you want to view it on a 1-inch by 2-inch screen, that's cool. Hopefully you want to see it on a big 60-inch screen, we want to be there. But it's about working with our cable partners and folks in our digital partners so we can get our content where people need to be.
Speaking of content, man, word is that there's a new Nas biopic coming out too, you guys?
Yeah.
How's that coming about? Like,
New Edition went really well, and luckily we were in conversations with working with someone on Nas's life, but it's exciting, it's New York based. He has gone through a lot of iterations in his career, so we're looking forward to exploring that.
So you had that tucked already, like if this New Edition pops off.
Our team was smart. We were like, this New Edition, it was a point in time where we realized, oh, New Edition is going to be big. Let's get a couple other stories that we'll have. And so we'll have for the next year or so, we got a few stories. You'll be hearing about them coming out soon. Mm.
So do you have any passion projects in particular? Or is this it?
New Edition was really a thorough passion project. You know, it's like asking about the kids. I know you hear this all the time, but like all of them passion projects. Right. Like I loved The Quad with Anika Noni Rose, which is on Wednesdays at 10 p.m. on BET, is a passion project. It's an HBCU, and from the adult's point of view, from the kid's point of view, we get into serious issues. It's a show like no other that's been on. So that's a huge project. Passion.
You know what? I actually feel in the streets now with all sorts of program. You know, I think we used to go to eras where people would reach a lot of criticism, a lot of hate towards BET. I feel like it's harder to hate on BET right now.
Yeah.
It's really harder. Do you feel that,
I have to agree because, look, I've been there when they were protesting in front of my boss's house about you know, videos that were on. But now it really feels like it's turned the tide, and I always felt that was unfair because Deb really took a boat of them Deborah Lee, the CEO of BET, had been taking a boat that had been going in a direction for a certain amount of time, and then kind of changed it into this original programming, right? So Being Mary Jane, The Game was really first, and then Being Mary Jane, Real Husbands of Hollywood, and now we're on with The Quad and the New Edition Story. So it's really about telling our stories really well in a different way. But it is hard to hate. We're trying to make it harder. Let's be clear.
That should be the new slogan.
We're trying to make it harder. And when people do hate, I'm like, some people still hate, like, but y'all have Uncut On. I'm like, we haven't had Uncut On for 10 years. Like,
right.
If you're hating, turn us on. If you're going to hate it for what we're doing now, not for what we did.
So do we owe you responsible for the good and the bad of all this tenure? Like with your issues with BET Uncut?
Elliot, I don't know. So call them out by name and I'll let you know.
BET Uncut.
Both its advent and its being deceased. Yes.
Yeah.
Both of them. Look, back in the time, it was one of the it was
people were putting out videos and then censoring their videos so they could put them on BET or any other.
Because you guys sort of set the guidelines and standards.
Right.
Yeah.
But again, in the desire to have people present their art the way they want to. Right. And I want to thank you for having me on the show, because y'all usually have creators on here. I feel like I'm a curator.
Right.
And so I'm part of it is like having people express their art the way they want to. Mm. Right. And so for our standards, we had to edit some videos. But then we like, okay, if it's 3 o'clock in the morning, and it's 3 o'clock in the morning, and people want to express themselves in an uncut way or the way they want to, we want to be able to have people show their art the way they want to. Not everybody calls it art, and I respect that. That's fine. But the goal was to have people present the art the way they wanted to. Mm. And then Uncut came along, and then it started doing crazy ratings. And then Patti
LaBelle. Like 3 in the morning ratings. Just ring
three in the morning. Oh, 3 in the morning. 3 in the morning. And I'm like, if your 12-year-old is up watching BT at 3 o'clock in the morning, we're not the problem.
Right.
Right. We're not the problem.
Right.
But it ran its course, and then people started making videos just for Uncut. Mm. I think
took
that's
the art away from it.
That's where it went. That's where that took away from the purpose and it, purpose.
Do you remember the first time you saw the tip drill video?
Absolutely, 100% full stop. Yes, yes.
What was your thoughts?
I'm gonna be honest. I thought it was. It was way out there, and the thing is, I don't remember any other part of that video except the part that everybody else remembers, the credit card sliding down.
Mm.
Yeah.
And given that there was a bunch of videos at the time with money being thrown and everything else, I enjoy clever, right? Yeah. I enjoy clever. It was
clever,
borderline, but it was clever. Like given the, you're throwing money. Oh, this is a different way of doing money. It's clever. Now, is there anything we'd show any point in time other than 3 o'clock in the morning? Even then,
yeah,
heck no. But
would you call like Nelly and just make a joke about it and shit? Like, what's going on, Nelly? We don't know about this, Cornell.
So the jokes lived for a minute, and then all of a sudden it got dead serious because people started protesting Nelly and showing up. He was doing bone marrow drives.
They would show
for his sister, and then they'd show up and protest at a bone marrow drive. Yeah. I'm like,
this guy real.
So it got serious too, really quickly.
Right. Yeah. I feel like a silent majority wants to bring back Rap City and the whole. Recently Don Q tweet about bring back Rap City. Like, what's up with that? Like, is that possible?
On television, again, if it involves videos being shown on television, I mean, we're a business. We are a business. We are trying to get the most viewership, and we realize that people watch videos online.
Right.
That said, we're always talking about different ways. Maybe there's a digital execution of Rap City. Mm. Maybe you take the Rap City spirit and find a way, especially in the digital space, to do it. Mm. We still do not Rap City, but we still obviously have hip hop on MTV Jam, on BET Jams.
Just change that up soon.
I did, right? Jams, yeah, yeah. BET Jams, but we've been with us for a year now, and so but Rap City itself, it's kind of attached to video. There's attachment to videos and that stuff to do on TV.
But it's funny, you dead these brands, and then the people want them to come back. Like, 106 and Park, bring back Rap City.
Yeah,
what do you think it is? You think it's just the sort of spirit that's missing?
It's a nostalgia. It's a nostalgia. Folks like, and it's funny. Nostalgia used to have 20 year cycle. So the 50s were really big in the 70s. The 60s were big in the 80s. And then I think because of social media and because of the access to information, that time cycle got really, really short, right? So the 90s became big right at the beginning of the 10s. Right, and now people want to go back to we're at 17, and people want like, ooh, 08-09 was dope, right? So it's just compressing that time, but it's all about nostalgia.
Right. Who's the BET viewer now?
Ooh, the BET viewer now is black between the ages of 18 to 49, probably towards the top end of that. Mm. Lots of them live in what I call the Crescent. The Crescent is a southeast portion of the United States. I call it Crescent because like it's a crescent move. Like it starts out of the tip, like maybe New York or Philadelphia, comes down and fattens out down around the Carolinas, and then goes down along Alabama, Mississippi, and probably the last tip is at Houston. Mm. But a big wide swath of the southeastern United States.
Gotcha. Is there like a place for, as far as programming goes, for like Teen Summit? In this day and age,
again, nostalgia. Yes, nostalgia. But I'm seeing a lot of the elements of Teen Summit online. You talk about how digital is affected. It's it's hard to do shows like Teen Summit because there's a lot of that advice on the there's a lot of that advice that people can go to when they want to. Mm. And a lot of what we do depends on you watching it like Tuesday at 10 o'clock or at least watching it 3 days later. That's mm. What really counts for us.
Mm. Mm. Makes sense.
I want to go back to the beginning of your journey though, because I know a lot of it, you talked about passion earlier, a lot of it just comes from your love of music and your passion for music, right? Growing up in D.C., like, I see you got the Michael Jackson shirt, like, I've seen you put photos up where you're literally like the kid in the front row taking a picture of Michael Jackson in the crowd, right?
Absolutely. I grew up in D.C. There was nothing better than sitting in my dad's Mustang, driving with him on a Saturday, and it was like Mustang when the Mustangs first came out, like 67, 68 Mustang, and driving to listen to WOL AM radio, and just, you know, Temptations, James Brown, Joe Tex were the people just like my first idols. And so I just thought everybody was thoroughly captured by music as I was. Mm. It's only like 2 years ago I realized, oh no, maybe I like it a little bit more than everybody else. You mean not everybody's a 6 year old reading all the credits on albums and singles, nah?
Right.
But yeah, and it continued through college where I got on a radio station for the first time. They were recruiting people, said, you come here and you get free albums and you get free concert tickets. I'm like,
that's how they got me.
That's all I spend all my discretionary income on. So right. Disposable income. So
my grandma's like, you get this for free?
Yeah.
You didn't steal this?
And it still has a stamp at the top where it says like, this is not your property. It's the property of the label. I hope they never come get it though.
that's promotional use only.
Exactly.
But radio, you thought was going to be your initial calling?
I wanted to be a program director. I wanted to be a program director and a morning person. That was my goal. That was Donnie Simpson in Washington, D.C. when I grew up in WKYS. I wanted to do, if I get up, I can do 6 to 10 mornings and then program direct for the rest of the day, run a radio station. And then when I left college, I still have many of the rejection letters I got. Wow. when I left college. You know, and then I was a teacher for a minute. And then I had the luckiest break in my life happened. The short version is someone got sick at my old college radio station. I hadn't been on for a year. I went back in, filled in for 4 hours, thought nothing of it. Elroy Smith, who is a radio programmer in Boston, happened to be driving through Providence, Rhode Island, heard me, called me, and I got in that way.
Wow. Right. Just randomly on the...
Dude, if a dude hadn't gotten sick, if I hadn't been home to answer the phone because there was no cell phones at the time, right? If Elroy hadn't been happening driving through, we wouldn't be sitting here right now. My whole career started that day.
So at the Boston radio station, that's probably the first time you started meeting artists like the Mariah Careys of the world, those type of people?
I met the Sugar Hill Gang when I was in college. Wow. I interviewed the Sugar Hill Gang when I was in college, and I thought that was the biggest.
Big Bang Hank?
Master G. Like, they played a roller skating rink in Providence, Rhode Island. And they said, yes, they're going to do an interview for you. I'm like, all right. I took a big reel-to-reel tape. Like, I didn't even take the little portable tape. I took a big reel-to-reel, the studio mic. And I was like, yeah. I don't remember what I asked them, but I remember Master G was kind of bouncing off of the walls. This I remember. You know what I said? You know what I don't know what you said. I don't understand it. But yeah, but started in college and then in WILD after that.
But in Boston. You were doing the morning show in Boston, though, right?
Yeah.
You became the morning show
guy. I became the morning show guy, and I became the program director and morning show guy in Boston. And everybody would come through. You name them. Brian McKnight, Vanessa Williams was hot at the time.
Smooth R&B.
Yeah, smooth R&B. but we also were, proudly, WILD was one of the first shows to have a mix show at what we called our night. I was a daytimer station, so we actually went off the air at like 8 o'clock. But from 7 to 8, Max Mix did the Thunderstorm. This is 1987, 88.
Wow.
And for Boston, if you ever know about Boston, that's big. Mm. That's big to have that there.
Wow. So, I mean, with the BET, with you guys do the awards, it must be really fulfilling when you have really these iconic moments like Michael Jackson and James Brown together on stage. Yeah. And like Tina Marie and Rick James, like.
We're always trying to put folks together. We're always looking for those oh wow moments, oh shit moments. Just where people are gonna be blown away. Mm. And we've been fortunate to have a few of them. Jennifer Hudson and Jennifer Holliday is one of my favorite moments because before they started rehearsing for that, they had never met each other.
Wow.
Right, that was when Dreamgirls, the movie was big, and there was all this talk about Jennifer Holliday had been disrespected. So what we always try to do for the, we're always trying to bring the culture together in yeah. some way. As recently as when, you know, Trey Songz and August Alsina had their little beef, came to the BET Awards, and that's where you saw them together for the first time.
I was saying, how do you have hip hop awards and there's no incidents? How do you maneuver that? You do the hip hop awards every year. 10 years, right? 10, 11 years?
Yeah. I think we're on year 11.
Wow.
And I think, honestly, I think it's because, and we've had warring factions inside the building, mm-hmm. let's be clear.
Yeah.
But I think most of it is they respect that what we're trying to do for the culture. Like, they don't want to mess it up. I'll tell you a story, this was the second BET Awards, right? And so we're going through the show, and Suge is in the building. And Suge was in the balcony. We put Suge in the balcony on purpose.
You tucked him.
tucked him and put a man on him. Let's be clear. Tucked him and put a man on him. That's for real. And Snoop was like, as you're facing the stage, I can see it on the aisle on the left right now. And Snoop was sitting on an aisle seat. And Suge somehow shook his man, came down to the main floor and was walking. He walked past me. I can see him right now walking out of peripheral image vision, walking down the aisles towards Snoop. And I know exactly what's about to happen, right? And so Suge walks up, you know, kind of steps to Snoop. Snoop stands up. And then I just remember I was literally sitting next to my mother. I jumped up and ran down. Now, I don't know if it's the right thing for me to do in Los Angeles to try to jump in between Suge and Snoop.
Hold on, you look like Jeff Van Gundy trying to break up the Lonzo Mourning fight or
right?
something.
Exactly. Because I'm not packing heat, that's for sure. Right? And so jump in between those two and just, it was about to escalate and it was during a commercial break. And Snoop just did an about face and walked away. And so I went back to Snoop, you okay? He said, yo man, any place else this would have set off, but I'm not about to damage you, what you guys are trying to do for the culture. Mm-hmm. And I've never forgotten that. Like, because tensions were high at that moment, but Snoop had a beautiful sense of mind to remove himself from the situation. Mm-hmm. And he was thinking about what we're trying to do for the culture.
Right. Yeah.
I feel like the award shows are kind of undervalued when BET does them. Like, when you really think about it in the context of the things that you guys have done, like I said, you know, James Brown and Michael Jackson together, that hasn't been done since Jay-Z performing Izzo for the first time.
Yeah.
Yeah, how did that come about? I got to do my new shit, Steven.
Yo, that's one of my favorite stories of all time. That was our second award show. It may have been our first. May have actually
first
been our
one,
first,
2001,
award, first
one.
Award yep. show. We had done the 20th anniversary the year before that, and he hits me. He's like, "Yo, I want to do a brand new song." And I'm like, "Well, we're trying to build this show, so let me make sure it's filled with hits." No.
Give me the hit.
I want to do a brand new song. I was like, "I said, just come by the studio and hear the song." And I remember it was the same night that Mariah Carey had some kind of party it may have been for the movie. Mm. I remember leaving there with my boy Scott and was like, okay, I got to go over to Jay's studio and hear the song because he wants to do a new song for the BET Awards. I'm trying to keep it hitting lead. And so we go over to the studio and Jay plays H to the Izzo. I'm like, got it. Understand what this is. Let's find a way to do it creatively and have fun with it. But yeah. Because it's a one listen song. Like it's one, not one of those you need five or six listens. Like,
right.
Understand what this can be. Understand how this can, how you'll be able to perform this. And then he added the R. Kelly back, you know, tape behind him. And then the great thing about that is there was a beautiful moment where everybody from the South, the West, New York got up on stage with Jay. And got up on stage during that performance.
Yeah, I remember Biggs was saying some Andre 3000 was giving him a standing ovation.
Yep,
was into it.
Yep, stuff, yep, energy. Yep. But it's tough, you know. And now, you know, we want world premieres now. Now, if you want to do world premieres, like it's a great idea. But Jay had, you know, as always, he had the presence of mind. He had the, like, I want to do something that's never been done before, and that's premiere song on an award show. So.
Well, what was that moment about at the 2015 awards where you and Rihanna, she threw like something at you and
money, threw money at you? Was that real, Steven? What's going on, brother?
Look, all I want to say is that we cool now.
Wow,
we cool, we're good. We took a picture right after that. You know, we got through it. We got through it.
Right.
Yeah.
We got through it. I was hot in the streets though for a minute though.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. When my nephews tell me. oh, you're hot in the streets right now? That's how I know. It's not the streets I go on, but those I knew then. Yes, indeed. Yeah. Yeah,
but how do you do, like, that's part of the relationship, right? You have to manage relationship. I would say, like, you know, you'd be like, you're cool with this person, you're not cool with this person, mm-hmm. but part of our business is managing relationships.
Yes.
Can you talk a little about your advice on how to do that? Because you've had to navigate for so long of your career and being the go-to person for these decisions and culture.
The way I like to think of it, it's a long game. It's never, there's always going to be another chance where you come back around. So sometimes you'll get the no. But a lot of times you'll get the yes, and there, after a lot of yeses, there may be a no, but you gotta, both to me and from me, but okay, cool, we'll go, and we'll come back and approach this again. But if folks, and I've seen it happen, folks fly off the handle because they don't get the weight they want either every time or one specific time, it doesn't make for a good long-lasting relationships and long-lasting relationship. And the people I've seen succeed in this business and really able to take it to the next level, the ones who understand that really early in their career.
Yeah. Is there any plans ever to bring the award shows to like New York? Because we have the BET Awards in LA, the Hip Hop Awards in Atlanta. What gives?
We are looking, I won't say which show, we are looking for an opportunity to bring and I've never said this out loud before. We are looking for opportunities to bring shows to New York. Mm. At least one of the big ones to New York. Absolutely. We love the places we've been before, but we always want to try out something new as well. Mm. Actually, I heard Lior Cohn say it on Rap Radar podcast. Like, you want to look you want to make things better when they're not broken. Mm. Right, and there's nothing broken about it, but there may be ways we can make it better. And moving into New York and putting in this energy could do that.
What's your craziest Lior Cohn story? You segued it too nice. I can't resist.
I don't have one. Really? I'll be honest, I do not have one.
Steven, you play our videos for free. We give you free content, and you make millions.
No. That's not.
But in the beginning, take people back. With videos, the labels would give you videos, you get it for free, and be able to play them. That was a wonderful business model, right?
The craziest business model. I mean, there were a number of channels who were built off of that model, where you get you basically get the free programming. What I wouldn't do to free get the quad free. You get a whole hour, 2 hours worth of programming for free.
But I feel like we always one of the first people to speak up and be like, why are we giving this away for free?
Wait, what do you mean? People have to pay to get their videos aired?
No. But
they spend money to create the video, and they got to send it to Steven to program a BET. He doesn't pay for it, the creation of it.
Right.
So Lior's paying for it, but he's profiting from building a business, showing the content.
And the premise was, and the record companies benefit from the free promotion, right? Especially when there weren't that many videos out, right? That was actually the case. Goodness knows the amount of play that Michael Jackson got on BET and MTV absolutely fueled the fact that Thriller is the number one selling album of all time.
It was
a handshake everybody agreed on. But then when the margins started getting smaller in music, that's when people start looking for, okay, how can we find revenue anywhere? That's when it kind of all changed. Mm. It was a perfect relationship for a long period of time. We'll give you the videos for free. We'll spend $7 million. Yo, there's an accountant somewhere who thought, okay, we can spend $7 million on a video, give it to people, but they'll play it enough that we will more than recoup that in album sales, right? That's the only way it makes sense financially. Yeah. And for a while, that was indeed the case. And then you know, digital. We talk about it all the time. The digital.
What are some of your memories of videos that you famously rejected and caught a lot of heat for, and you wouldn't play it, and just the labels or either management was mad at you? Like, what are some of those stories you feel like you didn't play something? And also, people that changed their video to appease you and ended up playing it on BET.
Alan Grunblatt reminded me of one the other day that he changed. Ray J's "Can I" came in, and it was the most lascivious piece of celluloid tape I'd ever seen in my entire life. I was like, "Are you slapping an X rating on that bad boy?" And I'd forgotten about it. He said they went back and changed it at MTV. And I love this because I get to shout out one of the most innovative people ever in this business who passed away far too early. MTV, as I remember it, first got, I think it was the Dead Presidents video from Jay. It was like, we'll pass. And Fred Jordan, Fred Jordan. I'll never forget him coming to my office. He had a three knock. I think you might want to, y'all might want to relook at this Jay-Z. I think he's gonna be something. He's gonna be something. And obviously, we looked at it again, and he was right. We took it, and you know, he called Cash Money long before it happened. He called D'Angelo long before, and unfortunately, left us far too early this century. But the Jay-Z, when I was in MTV, that was one that we passed on, and like, that doesn't make any sense to pass on that. There's probably a number that have changed over the years. I can't remember, though.
But it was such a big process for how you guys would select the videos you would play, like the programming, right? I mean, I know 106 Park was the request line, but outside of that, programming-wise, like, what was your guys' approach of the standard of how you would pick what videos you would play and stuff like that?
We always wanted to, I got the programming from radio, right? You want to play the hits, and you want to nestle in between the hits something new that no one's ever heard of. Mm-hmm. And shout out to Tuma Bassa, who's now over at Spotify.
Yeah, Tuma's good guy.
And Kelly G, who's over at Revolt.
Yeah.
They really, especially in the early days of my tenure at BET, really led kind of the music path and the folks that we helped find. You know, I say to this day, Kanye West is like, nobody believed in Kanye, including some people in his own building, more than Kelly G did. Mm. Like, Kelly G was the guy who's like, there's something special about this. Now, take it with a grain of salt, because Kelly G's from Chicago, and Kelly used to holler everybody from Chicago.
Right.
But on this
one, they're gonna blow.
in the middle of the barn.
Gives you conflict.
Yeah, gives you conflict. I can't think of the name for a minute. But there was, and you know, Nelly, we shepherded along Kanye.
Yeah, Kanye would be up at MTV all the time building that relationship.
In the early days. So, but it was people like that and other folks on the team who really were crucial. It was crucial to find the next big thing that's about to blow.
Yeah.
Is there ever a video that came across your desk that you knew that this person's going to become a big star from the inception?
Yeah, Nelly Country Grammar. Nelly Country Grammar was like, well, there's no doubt about what
this is. He's breaking national. Yeah.
He's breaking national. Yeah. When I was at MTV, Eminem was clear. So as I remember it, we first got a video where he was killing his grandmother. And we were like, that's not going to work out. that's
Paul Rosenberg on the phone. Why, Steven? Why?
That's not going to work out. But then it came with How My Name Is. And as soon as we saw that, I remember the meeting. That was right before I left MTV. I was like, got it. Understand what this can be. I mean, didn't know it was going to be that big, but knew that. And candidly, B2K. When B2K came out, simply because there was a dearth of boy bands that especially young black girls have been able to attach themselves to for so long, knew that was going to blow. That was
going
to blow.
Going back to the beginning of BT, when your career there, I saw something you said too, that you was like, one thing you put your bet on was that, because I tell people, like, you look at the late 90s, we had just lost Biggie and Pac, and it was a tough time in hip hop. Yeah. But then the economic boom started happening, and it shifted, and it became this thing, and I think that was part of your vision, right? That hip hop is pop culture, and now it's going to take its place in the forefront.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
But I always believed that BET was part of pop culture. It wasn't, you know, the rest of pop culture and BET. Like, what we were doing was giving signals to pop culture and helping
Black culture is pop culture.
Pop culture and black culture is pop culture. But then it was kind of the nascent part of that. And I think we really were able to grow into that, especially with 106 and Park. Mm-hmm. When 106 and Park started beating its competitors that had been around for a while, that's when I think even the, Not the industry. Like, I think we always had the people watching, but that's when the industry started taking notice.
What, beating like TRL, like head to head type of thing?
Wow. Yeah. Yeah, I still have the champagne bottle in my office from the first day that happened.
Wow.
It was a goal that we had, but when it happened so quickly, we were all blown away.
Mm-hmm. What do you attribute it to? Like, or talk a little bit about even putting
AJ
putting
and
that
Free.
Show together.
AJ and Free. Look, that, I mean, so that show. I mentioned I came at the beginning at the end of '99, September 2000. Oddly enough, September 11th, 2000, wow. 1 year before 9/11, is when 106 and Park kicked off.
Wow.
AJ, we found because AJ was a party promoter, and AJ was going to help us find the people who were going to populate 106 at Park. And when I met him and hung out with him, I'm like, that's him. That's him. Shout Yolanda Starks, who first said, okay, AJ's a guy who's going to help us do this. But once you hang out with AJ, you're like, oh no, he's the character. He's the guy we need to do this. Mm. And Free, I knew from my days in Boston. She used to hang out at the radio station. She was like, every radio station has that, like, the 16, 17-year-old who wants to learn everything and know everything. That was Free. And so I ran into Free at a Busta Rhymes party at what is now Terminal 5.
Wow.
In about July of 2000. I remember it was then because we had found AJ and was like, I knew we wanted to have two people. I knew we'd have a man and a male and female. And like, it was just, I couldn't find anybody. There was nobody. We'd gone through auditions after auditions in different places. Mm. And Free walked through, and I realized, I was like, oh my God. And I hadn't seen her in probably 3 years. I was like, that's exactly who it should be. Mm. And she came to the audition, she was hoarse the next day. And I had to convince some other people, like, just trust me. She's gonna come, just bring her to the callbacks. She's gonna kill it in the callbacks. And she did.
Wow.
What was the first big success on the show that you think that really started taking a brand to where it ended up being?
So it's two things. One, Donnell Jones was hot as he could be at that moment. Mm. And Donnell Jones was the first artist who, when he was hot, would come back like on a Monday of 1 week and a Wednesday of the next week if we asked him to, because he believed in the brand. While when you start a new brand, people have got to test it out and feel if they're going to be involved with it. So you're not going to get any big stars. But he had a huge hit, and he had two huge hits at that time, and he came back. And so Donnell Jones kind of started it. And my point to that story is, every other time Donnell Jones came out for the next 14 years, no matter how hot or cold he was, we always had a place for him. By the way, that's what we called it. We called it the Donnell Jones rule. It doesn't matter what. Donnell Jones is always welcome on 106 in Park because he was the first big guy who messed with us. And then to bring it all back around, Whitney Houston and Bobby Brown came on to surprise. Because they were home watching, and they liked the show. And the moment they stepped on that stage, it was almost like the bookings changed immediately.
Wow!
And they called us to can we come
over?
They just popped by. Wow! They just popped by. And I remember Free, because Free was a Whitney Houston is a Whitney Houston nut. But that was it. And it was just wonderful to have that time where you have a smart black man and smart black women on every day. It happens a little bit more now, but there's never been, I don't think there's any been a show in 14 years you have smart black men and smart women, black women. It's not an era that, usually we had a host that had gone to an HBCU, right? So we want to make sure that inside the music you would get, and they would talk about books they were reading. So it was about the entirety of the culture, not just about the music.
Yeah. Is there ever going to be a space where we could see these interviews and things like that? Because there's a lot of classic moments on. From 106
I was gonna say, what were some of your favorite moments? Be that I was trying to think.
I mean, in general, I was in high school at the height of 106 in Park. So I remember Monday morning, the water cooler talk was the battles. Care about Poster Boy versus Jen. That was it. Those were the biggest moment for me. And they just have other little moments here and there, but that right there is what sticks out the most, the Freestyle Fridays.
Fridays were great, were a fan. I used to love Freestyle Friday. And Jen still to this day,
deals off of that. Like Poster Boy had got signed, Jurassic Harlem. Like that was a moment.
Jen got signed.
Rough Riders.
Rough Riders. That's right. And then there are great times like when the 50 Kanye is one of my favorites.
Oh yeah, 50 Kanye was 50, dope, yeah. 50 and Jay Kanye was backstage, right? Jay was there too.
Yeah, yeah. Something 50 still doesn't forgive me for to this day. There was a misunderstanding about how that was all supposed to go down.
Please explain.
Nah.
For the sake of clarity, Mr. Hill.
Okay, so it became a thing with 50 versus Kanye, and so.
People don't realize how big this was.
It was one of those things where both of them, I think, benefited.
And everybody thought 50 was going to win. Everybody did.
Not everybody.
The majority did.
It was a close battle. People thought it was great television and one of the highest rated 106 and Parks of all time. And so in preparation, we want to make sure everything was even. And so we get different questions from management on different sides, like, can we do this? Can this happen? Can this happen? And I think and as I've heard it from 50 side is that as I recall it, Kanye's side asked, can we bring a guest? We said yes. There was no same question from the other side.
He's like, I would have got Eminem. I would have brought Eminem.
And that was exactly what it was. But we weren't running to each side and saying what the other one was doing. We're just answering the questions of whatever each side asked. That side asked, can we bring? We were like, cool. And so that question didn't come from the other side. And so somebody thought it was unfair. And I understand where that thought was. Maybe we should have gone and said, like, well, they're doing this, so you should know this. But the idea was, if you ask us, we'll respond, but we're not going to go to the other side. We didn't go to their side with any of the questions they had either. Mm. So
when did Feff realize that Jay was in the building, and did that affect the taping at first?
Or no. As I remember, it did not affect the, and I think we did that. Did we do that one live? I think that was a live one.
Wow.
It did not affect the taping. It affected the conversations I had for the next 2 months after that.
But speaking of which, I know you had a great relationship with the RIP Chris Latty, great person. Yeah. You know?
I still miss that dude to this day. No one more smart, no one more of the culture, no one more protective of the culture than
yo
Chris
B,
Lighty.
Yo B.
Yeah. Yo B. Yeah, that was him. And it's tough to lose friends always. It's really tough to lose them in that manner. And when you realize there's so much more potential. There was so much more they had to do for the people they were already doing it with, but mostly for themselves. It's just unfortunate.
Right.
It's just really, he was a fantastic, fantastic human being.
Right. Going back to my original question about the housing, the old school throwback
content. He wants some clips,
like,
Steven.
Think
he
about it. Like, you can't find the Jay-Z, Big Pimpin'.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. No. So anything with music, obviously, is difficult to clear because to the point. Okay. So we can bring it back around to we got the videos for free, and we used to be able to put stuff online easily.
Right.
And now, you know, as the margins get smaller and record companies are rightfully looking for other ways to get their revenue, they're like, no, you can't use the music online unless you pay us for it.
Wow.
Right? So it's a tough thing to, anything with music is a tough thing for us to put online for free because it just economically doesn't make sense for us to put old stuff on. However, we are currently combing for interviews, some stuff that happened from the basement, the basement, and anything that we can use that has music that we don't really have to clear, or it's not going to be that expensive to clear, you will hopefully see on BET.com, BET Digital, that coming your way.
Like, the only time Jay-Z ever performed Big Pimpin' with Pimp C and Bun B was on 106 and Park. Remember that moment?
Mm, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm, yeah.
Like, you can't find that.
That was the only time?
Yeah. I mean, that I've known of.
I think, wasn't Jay and Nas on 106 and Park too, right? I can't find that online either. I can't find that on YouTube.
Yeah. There's a lot of stuff that came out.
There's a lot of bootlegs, though. The Rap City Freestyles is bootleg heaven on YouTube, right?
Oh, yeah, there's a lot of bootleg. Shoot, we had to look up. I found the bootleg for the whole, in the New Edition story, we had the time they were on Video Soul, all six of them. That's bootlegged on YouTube too.
Yeah,
but right now, just, you know, it's also on BT.com. So go there and see the pristine, clear version of that interview.
Wow. So much history, so much. I remember when I saw a previous interview you had did. You talked about like how people wanted to be in the business and things like that. You said getting on public access was a good way to kind of break out. Do you still believe that?
I think it's changed. That's a great point. That interview was from probably 12 years ago, before there was so much, before there were cameras on phones. Mm-hmm. Right.
Damn.
And so now it's not public access at all. Now you can record yourself and put yourself up and get discovered that way. And it's not only about being discovered, it's about doing it and improving. My point about public access was do it and do it repetitively, because you get better in repetition. Mm-hmm. You get better in repetition. Right. You guys are better now than you were when you first started.
Absolutely.
Like, we still
suck.
No. Oh, no. Don't even. And so I think what you can do now is like put yourself up there, have yourself a perspective, a point point of view, even if you're reviewing movies. I've seen some of the funniest stuff I've ever seen have been bad reviews of BET Awards because they had a great perspective and they were able to frame it where they don't just say, oh, that sucks, that sucks. They're able to pull it apart. Like, this is why it could, this is how it could have been better, and this is how this person could have done. And I'm like, I respect it if somebody really has looked at it and can articulate their challenges with it. So I think there you can. It's not public access. It's really just being online.
I just thought of one more awards drama. We forget that T.I. got bagged at the Hip Hop Awards, right? Yeah. The big concert. How was that? What were those phone calls like, Steven?
Well, that wasn't us. So, how long ago? We were all having we talk about this still to this day. We were having a wonderful time the night before. We were jamming the night before, and we said
T.I. was the headliner, right?
T.I. was one of the absolutely.
Yeah. Wow.
And we, as we always do, we said to all the acts, we're like, hey, we're gonna send a car to pick you up. Come for rehearsal. He said, no, I'm just driving myself because I got something to do after rehearsal. And so. So he drives in, and I can still see him to this day. We came out of the venue, said, all right, I'll see you tonight. And he drove off.
Wow.
Got to the whatever the drugstore was, and then we like literally was like, he drove off. And then 20 minutes later, we're like, T.I. got arrested.
Wow.
Like, oh. So that was that. But it's that,
a lot of scrambling. Yeah,
there was a lot of scrambling, as there always is. I think Busta filled in. Busta came and did something dope that night to fill in that time. Mm. But he
didn't even realize how big it was going to be in that moment, I guess, right?
No, we didn't realize at all. But let that be a warning to all of you. When a show offers to give you a ride, take it.
Right. Speaking of scrambles, I'm just thinking about a couple that come into my head. When Michael passed, like, you know, what was that like? Because he passed like what, a couple
Thursday.
Days?
He had passed on a Thursday.
And then you guys had the award show that Sunday.
Yeah, we had it that Sunday. It was three days. Just about 3 days, because he passed about five Eastern time, so a little over 3 days to put that together. Look, you know, I just like shouting out people who do the awesome work, right? Ron Wisner, who was Mike's manager for a number of years, was one of our co-producers on the show. John Cassette, Jesse Collins again, and we just scrambled. We were like, and I will say this, I never wanted Mike to pass, mm-hmm. but I was really comfortable and okay that kind of that fell on us as the creative team, mm-hmm. and on a true Michael Jackson and Jackson 5 fan, right? I think that's why in the span of 3 days we could get the artist and it was the right songs, and we found the right pictures, and Janet understood what we were trying to do, and she called us, reached out and said, like, I get what you guys are trying to do. I want to come and talk to the family. Wow. And the cool thing about, not the cool thing about that, but the weird thing about that is that I was like, I remember saying, oh, we got to find a picture of Michael and Janet. Mm. And I was like, I know the exact picture. And we looked through the archives and found that picture. And I knew that picture because that picture had been hanging on my wall when I was a 12-year-old kid.
Wow.
In D.C.
Wow.
And so to have it all come full circle for that, and it was just if you see the framing of, you know, it's not two superstars, it's just a big brother and a little sister.
Right.
And her message was frankly, like, to you he was an icon, but to us he was family. Mm. I don't think we've ever had a team scramble and really pull off something like when Mike passed on the 2009.
So that's one of your proudest achievements, you think?
Absolutely.
And then with Chris Brown to the tribute, I mean.
Well, so the story with Chris Brown is, Chris Brown did the tribute in 2010.
Oh, that was 2010, okay.
Right? Because what happened is, that was Monday that week is when he pleaded, I think he pleaded no contest, or I forget what the plea was in court, but it got
revoked. Not guilty, I thought. No.
Okay. He pleaded to the Rihanna situation.
Oh, Chris Brown, you said.
Yes, Chris Brown. I'm sorry. Chris Brown pleaded. That was Monday.
Yeah.
Mike passed on Thursday, and the decision was made because we all knew that Chris was the perfect person to tribute Michael.
Right.
But we all realized that if Chris tributed Michael on that Sunday, it would be about Chris and not about Michael.
Mm-hmm.
Right. There was a lot of conversation, and shout out to his team for understanding how difficult that was.
Yeah.
But we also knew that a year later, he had done enough. He had seen the error of his ways and done enough, kind of repent. It was a rocky start,
right?
Definitely, it was a rocky start for him, but he finally figured it out, and we made the decision in 2010
to give him that moment.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, one of the things I said during that time is like, we're never going to throw a young black man away, right? And there were so many people who were willing to just throw him away because of a mistake he made when he was 19 years old. If everything I did when I was 19 years old came to light, if the worst things I did when I was 19 years old came to light, I wouldn't be here. And so you just can't throw a young black man away. And so in 2010, we wanted to give him that shot to tribute his hero that he didn't have the year before.
Previous year,
And he killed it. And he was just magical. He really embodied, I think he took all the passion and all the frustration he had that year and put it out the performance. And if you remember, he cried at the end of Man at the Mirror. And that was one of the moments where a lot of people turned the corner like, oh, he's a human. He's not this animal that I'd been thinking that he was. And again, we didn't plan that moment. That moment wasn't scheduled. But it was right for what we try to do in our shows and bringing people
and
together.
And with dealing with so much death, I mean, I know you had to do the Prince tribute last time, but I also saw that you said before that you had done a Prince tribute. So a lot of times, like even with Maurice White, you guys have given people their flowers while they're still here. Yeah,
thank you for saying, Elliot, thank you for saying that, because it's important to us, right? We were able to do it for Maurice White in Earth, Wind & Fire, in Lifetime Achievement. You talk about one of my biggest thrills was doing the tribute for Prince in 2010. Mm. When he let us have the Lifetime Achievement Award. And I truthfully, we'd approached him for years to do that, and he had said no. And I think I personally think part of his saying yes in 2010 was the passing of Michael in 2009. Mm. Like when Michael passed in 2009, he was like, okay, let me get
my flowers.
Yeah, let me do this. And one of the biggest career achievements ever was he was so pleased with how the 2010 thing went. I'd heard about it at the time, but then when he passed, two different people in his camp hit me and said, look, you need to know like what you guys did in 2010 by bringing people he truly loved. Alicia Keys, Esperanza Spalding, Janelle Monáe were the people who tributed him, right? And Patti LaBelle. Patti LaBelle kicking off her shoes during Purple Rain, right? He said he really appreciated that you knew what he liked. I don't know if you knew, Prince didn't really like male voices. Like Prince, like there were very few male voices. That's why he used to sing in falsetto because
Camille created the Camille thing.
Right, he would, all of his first records are in falsetto because he was trying to emulate the emotion that you can get in a male voice, in a female voice that's hard to get in a male voice. Wow. So he appreciated us putting that tribute together in 2006. That's one of the proudest achievements I think you would have.
I saw you said something. He said that he would call things that's disrespectful.
That's disrespectful. I first heard him. He was talking about an Esperanza Spalding show. And there was a show she played, and she had this great show, and she had a light on the side of the stage, and she didn't really interact with the light. And when it was time for the go, we were talking about, did you see? And she went over, she turned off the light and then rolled off stage. That was just disrespectful. That was disrespectful. I just love it. It's disrespectful.
The ultimate compliment.
Yeah, ultimate compliment is being disrespectful.
Well, that's definitely important. I love the fact that you guys do pay homage to the living artists in this day and age. It's almost forgotten about. It's almost forgotten about,
I mean, we look, it's
how do you keep the passion, Steven, that you don't let this industry jade you or break your spirit? And how much is it still your love and passion of the music and seeing live events that still fuels you?
Yeah, there's nothing I love more than going to a live show. There's nothing I love more than seeing a great execution live, right? I'm going to take it back to 2008 or 2009. When I first saw the Glow in the Dark tour by Kanye, I was like, this is like hip hop can take it here. Yeah. This is where it can be. I got to take it back to 2001. The Dre Snoop, that wasn't the Chronic tour. What was that tour called? I forget
up
what it was called.
Smoke?
Up and Smoke tour. Up and Smoke tour. The
Heavy Hitters.
Ooh. When Eminem is your opening act. When M is the opening act. I mean, and I especially love it when hip hop takes it to that level, when they take performance seriously. There's just nothing better than
Steven don't like when you cup the mic like this.
That's right, let it be open. But a Beyonce show, a Kanye show, anybody who really takes live performance seriously is I've never lost a passion. My mother still gets, don't you ever just want to settle? No, I want to go across the country. If there's a good show somewhere, I'm a Radiohead fan. I'm a Radiohead fanatic. If there's somewhere in this
world,
I want
to see you too. I saw
you too. No, you too. Oh yeah, absolutely. Because the music, I love the music. I love different types of music, but it's about the show, and it's what we try to put into the BET Awards. We've been really, really fortunate to have partnered with people and performers who really care about their live performance. Big Sean to me is
new album's out today.
New album, by the way, and that is halfway off the balcony. You're halfway
that's
off.
That's one of our favorites.
Yeah. Halfway off the balcony. Oh my!
That's a great record.
I've never heard someone just go along and all of a sudden their voice slows down and it never misses the beat and then it speeds back up to go to the regular speed. I was like, damn! And I'm sitting my whole time, I'm like, how does he do that?
Right.
Like, back to Big Sean had an awesome look on the BET Awards, I think 2 or 3 years ago. We had Scrim and he had snow falling and rain and like, I just love it when people care about the visuals and care about their shows. That means a lot to me.
Right.
Sean's going to call him on. Hey, right? Steve, I heard what you said on the podcast.
No, for real.
I was going to say, is it ever disappointing, you know, when you help an artist early in their career, then they get this, become this big A-list star and, you know, you want them to come back to do a show or a performance and they say no?
I'll be honest. Some people have decided when they... the game's changed a little bit. So... television looks, while still important to some, aren't necessarily important to everybody. And I respect that. I don't have a problem if people don't want to do TV looks. Hmm. I have a huge problem if people want to do TV looks at the general market, but don't want to do it at BET. Hmm. Right? If TV's not your thing, I'm good. I'm no problem, no harm, no foul. But if you want to go over there and do it and then not do it with us, especially when we were there at the beginning of the career.
What's under the blazer, Steven? What's under the blazer, baby?
Yo, that's just that's a problem. That's a huge problem. So, and it's, you know, I'm Scorpio. I remember. I'll remember.
Scorpio, Steven Hill.
But we really want to work with everybody, and we want to give a new act as good a look, as dope a look as an established act. Like Chloe and Halle on this past BET Awards had a dope look, and they tore the heck out of it. Anderson .Paak, one of my new favorites, first big TV performance on the BET Awards. Right, give folks a good look. So,
I know somebody else you're not feeling, Steven.
Who?
This president of the United States, this Donald Trump guy, man.
Here's why
you've been very public about it.
Here's why I love Donald Trump. Mm. Donald Trump doesn't believe there's global warming, so global warming's gonna come on. It's gonna mess up the weather. People gonna want to stay inside more, watch more television. Good for BET.
But you had
somebody else said this. It wasn't me that said this, and I don't know who said this. What Donald Trump wants is the adulation that comes along with the presidency. He doesn't want the job,
right?
He wants the adulation. He wants the look how big I am. Donald Trump is the only president who ever has been president, at least in the modern times, who's never held a job in public service, right? Yes, sir. His job throughout his entire life has been to increase shareholder wealth no matter what it takes to do it and market yourself while doing it. That's his little addendum, right? No other president has not had, every other president has had to, I know this is best for me, but what's best for the rest of the country is this, and so I'm going to do this. Mm. Every one of them, whether you're a senator, whether you're a congressman, whatever you're doing, you've had to have that moment of like, I've got to step back because this is better for the populace, not our president. Mm-hmm. And I think that's informing some of the things he's doing, his desire to currently overuse executive orders. Everybody uses executive orders, but his current desire to do that is based on, you know, being an executive. He's used to being executive and saying this is the way it's going to go, and that's not the way it works when you have, you know, the judicial branch and the legislative branch. So
the previous president, though, you gave the ultimate send off. Why weren't we invited to this party, Stephen? We heard this was amazing. This White House party.
Wait, the invite. See what had happened was. Yo,
Steven, I have your email, brother. What happened, man?
We were swag surfing in the White House.
Wow.
Swag surfing in the White House. D-Nice, DJ turned down.
Shout out D-Nice.
D-Nice turned down the volume at one point in time during the song, and inside the White House, you could hear people say, I call a heffernay!
Barack, those young and May.
How can you replace Barack?
Yo.
That guy is the legend, man.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was a fantastic 8 years for understanding and having cultural diversity. I think we got lulled into a false sense of security around that, and that's coming to us really quickly. But we can never not have President Obama, right? And so in 20 years, when my 12-year-old nephew grows up, there's no limit on his belief that he can be president of the United States, right? Because it's happened before. So the dividends that Obama's time has is going to pay off years and years and years from now. Mm. So I feel comfortable with that.
So we stay positive, right?
Like you have to stay positive. There's nothing we can do about it. Like, look, some of us, when Brexit happened, we're like, oh, Donald Trump's going to be president. Mm-hmm. Once Brexit happened over in the UK, oh, shoot, Donald Trump's going to be president. And here we are. Here we are.
So we're
messing up traffic on Fifth Avenue.
Would BET give him a platform?
Absolutely. Donald, President Trump, please, if you would like to come talk to the... Well, that's right, because he changed it from Black History Month to African American History Month because he was the person to do that. So if you'd like to come to talk to the African Americans whose names you just changed, come on to AAB, AAET. Do we have to change our name? Do we have to change to African American Entertainment Television? Was that a natural, was that executive order he gave? That everything black is now African American? Did I miss? All right, we're BET still. We're good.
Oh my goodness. I'm gonna call my accountant today and make sure everything's good in my life.
That's right. Do that.
Steven, this is incredible, man. This is entertaining. We'll be doing an hour here, man.
This
is amazing.
Oh, I'm getting kicked out now? That's it?
No, we got more. What else you want?
Okay.
I want to know, how did you end up in the BET, in the biopic for the new edition? Did that really happen?
So
you're like the Stan Lee of BET.
So it happened. So you know, as it was any kind of, you know, we have 6 hours to tell 30 years worth of story.
Right.
So while I was involved in the gathering together of New Edition at that time, it didn't happen just like that. Mm. And I didn't have a 6-foot-fine Nubian girlfriend on my arm when it happened. Shout out to casting for that one more time. That was pure heaven. Can we do that take again? Oh, that was me all day. Can I have that take with a 6-foot again? There was a moment when I made a call and see if we can get everybody together for the, and it was for the 2005 25th anniversary for BET. Mm. So that part was true.
Okay.
But it wasn't at Ronnie's wedding and I didn't have a 6-foot.
So at the, so you're going to be like at the Nas biopic, like live at the barbecue? Like,
no, hey, no. No, no, I will not be doing that. I'll be having Idris Elba play me. Idris Elba will play the role of me in that one.
What's on Stephen Hill's classic hip hop playlist?
You could laugh at the first one that popped to mind. Packet Man, Digital Underground.
Wow,
Packet Man, Digital
Shout
Underground.
Out to the wife.
You know, absolutely. Natural Born Killers, Dre and Cube.
You say this like this is the most obvious choices. These are like very.
He's like, yeah.
No, I love it. Elevators, Elevators, Outkast. The whole Graduation album. Mm. It's so hard with him to pick a favorite song, but if I got to go with something, it'll have to be Graduation.
The whole album.
Was it Good Life is the one. He played for me in the studio and it had completely different drums the first time. Yeah, I think Timbaland came and did the drums on.
That was Stronger, I think. No, Stronger was that one? Maybe Good Luck too. He always changed the drums.
Yeah, he changed the drums on that one. Other things on my classic hip hop list. MC Light's verse from Self Destruction. I don't like the whole song, but I love
LL Cool J wrote that for.
I know.
There we go.
Yep. I love that one. So oddly enough, two of my favorite verses in all of hip hop are by women. Light's verse from Self Destruction, mm-hmm. and Kim's verse from All About the Benjamins. I love that verse. What else would be my classic hip hop? Chino XL Creep.
Wow.
Chino XL Creep. Chino XL Creep. Dang.
That's a very obscure list right here, though.
What are some of your favorite, like you said, you name drop, but Jay playing you Izzo, this one playing you that. Like, what are some of your favorite listening sessions? Like,
who's gonna stop me from Watch the Throne? Oh, yeah. I love the way that thing moves. Love the way that thing moves. What were you saying? I'm sorry.
The private listening sessions. Like, what are some of your favorite artists presenting music to you? Like, you talked about Jay played you Izzo. You talked about Kanye Good Life. Like,
Kanye playing Monster for the first time, because it was just, the first time I heard it was just a beat in Nicki.
Mm. Oh, Nicki's verse is amazing.
Yes. Another one of my favorite verses of all time.
A female.
Yes. Yeah, it was just the beat and Nicki.
Wow.
And which is why it makes sense. What happened to the rest of that song is so dope, because if everybody was hearing Nicki go first, I still beat him though. No comment. that was Elliot Wilson who said that, not me. Some great Mariah listening moments. Oh man, somebody's gonna kill me for that. I heard a lot of Sean's. Only because I happened to be going to see Jay Brown, and I got there early, and Sean was playing some of his album, and I was like, "Oh, no, sit out here."
Oh, Big Sean.
Yeah, Big Sean was playing some of his album. I was like, "Okay, I don't want to interrupt." He's like, "No, come on in." I'm like a little kid in a candy store. When I get to hear some good new music, I'm like, "Okay, I'm here. Yeah, I'm right here."
It was the album you just dropped now.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I decided.
Yeah. Some other great. You know, one of my favorites was, I didn't get it at the time, and it turned out to be that. So when Puff first played, he played No Way Out, and I was at MTV at the time, and he played that. I remember what he was wearing. He was wearing, because I ended up buying it, I bought it. I was like, oh, it was a polo. It was like a cashmere polo sweater. It's dope, with the little horse on the left breast. And he said, I know what Big is, but I want to be Bad Boy's MC Hammer. Mm. I remember who said that, and wow. I was like, I didn't get it at the time, and then when it all came out and the shiny suits, I'm like, that was the vision. It wasn't exactly Hammer, but exactly what he said. And we all kind of like, you want to be that? You know, this was, what was the year? I'm going to get the year wrong. 98.
Yeah, about 97.
Yeah, 97. Yeah, it had to have been 7. It was, that was dumb of me. It was 97. But that's exactly who he became. He became the shiny suit and the fun having guy of hip hop at the time.
How did you feel when he said, "I'm starting this thing called Revolt, Steven. My own channel, buddy. Playboy, take that.
Playboy, yo, check this out, Playboy. I'm about to start my own channel. Yo, Playboy, check this out. I want folks to win. At that point in time, we were really coming off of. We were waning on our our ability to play music on television, and we really had to get more into original programming. Mm. So it wasn't, you know, a year or two earlier, it had been a different thing, but I was actually happy that music was still going to exist on television. Mm. And I'm happy that it still exists today, that people can go to, if they want to go to television and have a curated experience in music, there are places to go and see in Revolt do that. So yeah, I was happy for him. Like I said, a couple of years early, be like, really?
But do you still consider yourself like ultra competitive? Like, if somebody's under their breath raving about an unsung episode, you're not really feeling that? Like, do you feel yourself competitive fire
culture? I am ultra competitive, but I don't begrudge people their successes, right? I just want to be able to beat them. I don't want them to not have successes. I just want to have better success. I want us to find the better shows. I want us to develop the thing that everybody wants to see, right? I got great pleasure out of New Edition story and people hitting us and saying, like, you should be, given the other biopics we've had to suffer through, you should be responsible. BET should be responsible for all biopics.
Right.
And I don't want other biopics to be bad. I just wanted ours to be great. Like, I just want ours to be great. So in that way, I'm really ultra competitive. But I'm not begrudging people. I'm bummed that we didn't get the show if it works somewhere else. And I'm fiercely protective of our people, like our team. I don't want our team going somewhere. And like, you know, I want to make sure y'all feel good. So y'all want to stay with us.
Right. Is there a BET experience that hasn't happened yet? That's like on your wish list or bucket list?
Yes, believe it or not, we've worked with everybody. I've truly worked with everybody that I've wanted to work with. Right, we got to work with Michael Jackson, got to work with Prince, Drake, Jay, B, Eddie Murphy. Eddie Murphy is the one that's got away, and I'm from that time when the triumvirate was Michael Jackson, Prince, Eddie Murphy. That was it. The irony to me is that Eddie Murphy was never a hip hop guy, but he embodied everything the hip hop was about. Eddie Murphy was the first guy in motion pictures, first black man in motion pictures who didn't have to ask for anything, right?
His attitude was hip hop.
From Trading Places, right? Exactly. Yeah. But you know, he's an R&B cat, but everything about that was in his birth was right along the time when hip hop was kind of along, the early '80s, and he was the Trading Places, 48 Hours. He was the guy. He was always the guy in charge.
That's why you blew it up when he hosted SNL. You was like, when he came back to SNL or something, you was like, he didn't like that. That's in the realm, right? You were saying earlier, that's in the realm.
Yep. I'm like, we've come close a couple times. Oh no, I take that back. We had him on 106 in Park. We had him on 106 in Park once, and I couldn't be there that day. That's right. Because I had a vacation that I had planned literally for 2 years. And that was the one time he came on 106.
Oh, that's somebody fucking with you.
Yeah. By the way, I tried everything I could to move it. I was like, I'm gonna come back. It was like a 7-hour flight back just for that day. I was like, no. I met him before, but I've never. I always want to get him on an award show. Definitely want to give that man his flowers while he's still around. He's gotten some other places, but I want him to understand what he meant. Kind of what I was talking about. What he meant to black folks. Mm-hmm. What he meant to. Not asking for independence, being independent, right? And so that's what he meant. I think he means that to black. He's just funny to other cultures. Yeah, like he's just a really funny guy.
Through the voices that he did.
But to the black culture, he's like he was the first kind of hip hop comedian in terms of like I'm this is mine. I'm taking it. Yeah. I'm gonna be the lead guy. I'm not asking maybe for permission. I'm not Gene Wilder. You know, I don't love Richard Pryor, but. Richard Pryor was Gene Wilder's kind of sidekick, and you know there was some.
Eddie was always in the forefront.
Eddie was always that guy.
But the things you want for the awards, I saw some. You stick to that idea for years, and you keep trying to fight to make it happen. Because I think the some of female rappers, you got them together for the "Wanna Be Down" remix, right? Brandy and Yo-Yo,
Latifah.
He's I've been working 6 years on this.
Absolutely, dude. And it was always just one person. It's always like that one person who.
What was Yo-Yo doing? I love Yo-Yo. But come on, Yo-Yo.
I'm busy.
Yeah. That's right. But there are those things that Ellie, you're right. There are those things I get like that was one of them. I Wanna Be Down because. I just remember the first time I heard I Want to Be Down in the club, and when it goes, I want to be down, boom, boom, boom. And that bass, if you're in a big place and that bass hit, it was like, it just rattled the room. And also like, you know, again, the female camaraderie on that. Another thing we did a Good Times reunion a while ago, and Janet, believe it or not, was the one who was always down. Because we wanted to have the kids from Good Times and then have Janet walk out, which we eventually had. But it took us years to get that done. You know why?
Jimmy Walker?
Jimmy Walker is the correct answer.
He hates being JJ, that guy. Wow.
Jimmy Walker either had a comedy gig in like Skagoogie, Michigan, or something. But then one year we finally got it together. And I remember Janet had new management, and we said, we convinced your old management this is the right thing. Like, is it really going to work? Are people going to care? And she walked around there and got a standing ovation just from walking. I looked at the manager and said, like, so I had to beg you to get a standing ovation just from walking? Really? Right. Really? That's it? Those are the main ones.
She never gives up. Right. Steven never gives up.
No, dude, I'm getting Tony back together.
Wow.
You said, I saw something. You said that you begged them to not break up. And this is your man running around with a fake Tony. Now he's got like two other guys with him, right?
He's got Tim. Tim Kristen, their cousin, is still playing drums, but they have a guy who's not Raphael singing.
Come on. Nah, they come
can't
on.
Do that. Yeah, he's not Raphael.
You can't do that.
And they're calling it Tony.
Yeah.
So can we talk to Jermaine?
Yeah. Well, I'm not giving up. It's gonna happen. It's funny. As I understand it, they're cool as brothers, but it's just musically. I put it out there. On some show, we're gonna have anniversary and feels good. There's gonna be a moment when that's gonna happen.
Calligraphy's getting excited now. Look at him, he's tearing.
Is it easy? I mean, this might be a business question, but like, you know, for advertisers and people to invest in the BET experience, you know, it seems like when you guys have an award show or a performance, it dominates social media. Like, does that work? I guess in your favor, right?
Yeah. Oh no, we want to be as loud in the culture as we possibly can. The BET Awards was going fantastic, and so we've created this event around it, the BET Experience, which is 3 days of concert at the Staples Center. We take over LA Live downtown, and it really takes over social media. Like, it's one of the few on the ground events that's not on the air that can take over social media, because so many people who are active on it are there. And so that's opened up avenues for us, obviously, in business.
But not even necessarily the BET, as a whole, as a conglomerate, you know, with the award shows, even the biopic, it seems like that's all everybody was talking about. People might not necessarily be watching it, but they're somehow involved, at least on Twitter or on Instagram. And
you mean in the programming or
in the... I mean in the whole BET sphere, like, just in general, like...
I think it's one of the we're a network that proudly we carry this. People cheer for us, so they expect things from us, and they're really happy when we do well.
Right,
and that was proven out by New Edition. Like, the love that we got from the audience over New Edition. Like, we love that you're doing this.
How do you celebrate New Edition, Stephen Hill?
Every single day.
Did you pop a bottle?
So the great thing, it was three nights. And the bananas ratings started coming after the first night. And so we, and I got to shout out Zola Mashariki in LA and Latanya Newt, who really shepherded this project together along with the executive producer.
Shepherded this project. I like that.
Oh, it's true. With Jesse, who I mentioned before, and Chris Robinson. And so when that Tuesday, we got the ratings on Wednesday, we were like, we're partying. And then so we had Wednesday, and Wednesday's ratings, we partied on Thursday. Thursday, we partied on Friday.
Wow.
Because it had been a while. I mean, we get these on the award show, but this had been, as I mentioned, for some people, 10 years of labor of love. For me, it was 2 years, and something that we really wanted to have happen and show that we do right.
One thing I'm for, you beat the Donald Trump interview. Donald Trump's first interview as president.
Well, you know. Well,
Stephen.
You know, apparently he couldn't stop the rain. He couldn't stand the rain, so that's how it had to go. We wasn't trying to beat Donald, but we did. So we did take a time. I will admit, we took a time to just like, hey, let's look for other ways to do this, because this feeling is great. On the flip side, if we do something that's kind of jacked up, our audience holds us accountable for it, I think, in ways that they don't do other networks, right? You don't hear people going like, I'm cheering for ABC. Oh, I really hope CBS does well,
right?
But they do that with BET, and it's an awesome blessing, and I mean that sincerely. It's not a burden, but it's something we have to be really responsible with and responsible for.
Yeah. Is there something you wish you could do over?
There's a bunch of things first thing that come to mind, T.I. Sound went out in the BET Awards 2006, I think it was, and it's the only time we've had a catastrophic technical failure that wasn't anybody's fault.
Wow.
I would love to do that over. There was a mistake, there was a huge mistake, because we had a, you know, when we have the, when we give away the Viewer's Choice Award, we have one of our hosts with somebody who's just like who wins a contest,
right?
And the person who won the contest read a wrong name.
I remember this. Yeah, you got to be for that.
And it was, and I took responsibility for it, because at the end of the day, it's you know, I'm the guy behind the show, and but we could have done that better. And so the person who really won was upset, and the person whose name was called was upset. And it was an honest mistake by somebody who just, they're not trained in media, but you know, we could have handled that better. I wish one of the writers on 106 and Park hadn't written a joke about Blue Ivy. That was a very, very bad idea. There are lots to do. There are lots of do-overs. Luckily, there's more things that I'm really proud of than things I remember to do over. Because once, instead of doing a do-over, we just try to make sure we don't do it again. So one of the things I'm proud of our team, and we have a great team of folks, is that once they make one mistake, it's really rare that they make that same mistake a second time, right? And I think I'm hoping that we've built a culture that no one's going to come down on you really hard for the mistake. Just learn from it and don't do it again. The second time, maybe a little difficult. A little different, but that doesn't usually happen.
I was going to say, how would you describe your management style, and how do you think you've evolved and become a better leader?
Hire and bring on board talented people who have a passion for the culture and want to do the job, and let them do the job. I think I used to be much more of a micro manager than I am now. Candidly, I may have, and so I run that balance of getting in too far or being out too far, and getting in too far. And I think as I evolve as a manager, and everyone's still evolving, so I don't feel bad about that. It's knowing who needs you in at what level, right? It's really knowing your team and knowing the strengths of the team and playing to the strengths of the team. There's nothing, I think several teams have found that it's better to have a system built around the team or plays built around members' strengths than trying to force players into a certain kind of box. And I think my management style is is hopefully that way, playing to people's strengths.
Who do you consider like your star alumni? Like, you'd like to mention other names like that came from the BT tree that you're very proud. I know Terrence J just scored
Terrence J got a big deal. Roxy is doing her thing.
She won an Emmy Award too. Roxy.
That's right. She sure did. That's right.
Mm-hmm. Before we go
that's
further.
That's right. I forgot. She made the Emmy Award winning Roxy.
Before we go forward, I got to take a break. Why was Roxy mean to Terrence J that day? I don't understand what was going on.
Why was what?
Wasn't the famous instance she was mean with him on the air and she walked off the thing? Was that real? Like, what was wrong with Roxy that day? Why was Roxy so mean to Terrence J?
He teased her.
He teased her,
and then she walked off. I forget what that was about.
There was a lot of tension if you watched that.
If I'm not mistaken, didn't Roxy take a stack of money and throw it in Terrence's face?
That was you.
That was something different. My bad. I forgot about that.
No, but alumni, Terrence, Roxy.
AJ is doing his thing over on Extra. Tigger is killing it in radio down in Atlanta, and we still steal and bring him back every once in a while when we can. Donnie Simpson is still wowing him. He's back on radio and he's working with another network right now. But he's an all-star alum.
Where is Rachel?
Tuma at Spotify is an all-star alum.
You looking for Rachel?
Where the hell has she been?
Kelly,
she was bad.
Rachel is awesome. The mother of three kids.
Sorry,
what?
No, brother.
And married to someone I used to work with.
Oh, never mind.
Yeah, that's not.
And Ananda Lewis, she was gorgeous. Still is.
Yes, she is. I don't know where she is.
Instagram.
Oh, that's right. You know what? The funny thing is, I think of her as an MTV alum because she was at MTV when I was at MTV. I forgot she predated me at BET.
Oh, okay.
Yep. So who else am I missing? Who else am I missing? Shorty the Prince. Shorty the Prince is on KYS in Washington, D.C.
Hits from the street.
Hits from the street is in Los Angeles, living the life, looking like he's not a day over 25.
And you discovered him off of tape, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh yeah, hits from the street.
He just bogarted his way into the game, right?
Hits from the street walked into my office in a meeting that he wasn't supposed to be in. Everybody left the meeting, and he stuck around. It was like literally my second week on the job at BET. He said, "Yeah, I want to be. I think I should be on TV. And something told me his personality exudes. Like he exudes personality as soon as you see him. And something said, like, don't kick him out the office. Don't. and he said, I can do that. What do I have to do? I said, okay, so here's what I need you to do. Get a friend who has a camcorder and then go to Union Station and just start talking to people, just mess with people. And he said, but I don't have a camcorder. I said, if you really want to be on, you will find somebody with the camcorder and get this done. I've given you the task. And he came back a week later. I remember I asked for it on a Wednesday. He came back at Wednesday at 6 o'clock, right as he closed the business. He said, I got this tape. And it had to be, it was like a VHS, but he got it on a small tape, so it had to go in some kind of adapter. And I watched the first 15 minutes of that tape, and I've still never watched the last 15 minutes of it because the first 15 minutes got him hired.
Wow.
He was brilliant. He was brilliant. Yo, he went up to a guy, like, thug dude, and said, look, I'm buying my friend something for Christmas, and you look about his size. So I wonder if you could try it on for me. Dude's like, all right, man, what is it? I got him a condom. Could you try this on? Understand what this can be. And that was it's still one of my favorite shows.
That was a good show. See This World was pretty good too. That was Big Les, right?
Yeah, ahead of his time. Cali was the embodiment of CETA. Mm. It was animation, that kind of animation, like ahead of its time. Nobody else was doing that. And the cool thing about that is CETA could say stuff that no real live person could say and get away with it. Like, folks wasn't coming, knocking on the door like, where's CETA at? I got to beat her up for talking about me. So we got away with that.
Word.
Yeah, the only rap beef you've had is like Waka Flocka or some shit, right? That spilled out.
Forgot about that.
You and Waka Flocka squashed the beef, man. Y'all cool now, man?
No, we were cool afterwards. I apologize because I should have never.
Oh, you aired him out on social, I guess.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. I went slipped up because. So I guess I won't mention his name. Somebody came back because what he had done. This was on a, and this won't make sense. It happened on a hip hop awards. And we practice things, we rehearse things so that, again, going back to the beginning of this, so we can make you look as good as you possibly can. We spend a lot of money to make you look good. And then what he did, because we had flames in this, and so what he did was go out in the audience, some stuff he didn't do in a rehearsal at all, went around, cameras couldn't follow him. If you go far enough up an aisle, a camera can't follow you. Mm-hmm. So how are we going to capture your performance? And then he brought people on stage where there's pyro. Now, if you've ever done pyro on a show, when you do pyro on a show, in rehearsal, the fire marshal is there. They put you in one corner and tell everybody, this is the pyro that's happening during the show. They count down every hit of pyro. So there's a whole preparation for anybody who's on stage during pyro.
Where to stand and
right,
everything.
Right, exactly. Yeah. He brought people up from the audience and there was pyro. And so this is a liability for us, obviously. So somebody got me riled up because they were really mad. I was like, well, I'm mad too. My dumb ass. And so I said, Waka Flocka, I think it was Waka Flocka flamed out. It wasn't what social media is right now.
Yeah.
That was pre-Instagram.
Yeah, yeah.
But it took off in a way that things took off then. I was completely wrong to do it. I reached out to him. People thought I wasn't safe in the streets of Atlanta that night. I remember my boy from Atlanta was like, I'm gonna put a man on you. I'm gonna put a man on you just to make sure you're good. I reached out. He happened to be in New York, and we met. That happened on a Saturday, and we met on that Monday. And the cool thing about it, I realized how smart and aware of his surroundings Waka was. I apologized to him, and he apologized to me for, like, Once I mentioned the pyro
part,
thing,
yeah, he didn't think about that.
He completely got his, like, oh, I got it, I understand, and I apologize for the way I went about it. Yeah. And so yeah, but that was really dumb. That was dumb of me.
It was
to do
a little light blimp.
That was just, I gotta act better. I gotta do better.
So for the remaining of 2017, what can we expect from the network?
So we're in the middle of it right now. We have a mini series with Madiba coming out with Lawrence Fishburne playing Madiba. I smell the Emmy right now.
got the speech ready.
I can write the speech right now. The Quad, which is Life on HBCU, starring Anika Noni Rose and a cast of young hot folks who you will want to get to know. They're going to be stars one day. Rebel, John Singleton brought us Rebel, which is a story of a cop out of the Oakland area who is fighting both against the law and against blue, about being black and blue. We got the BET Awards, of course, coming up. Mm-hmm. June, let me get this right, June 25th, that's the last Sunday.
This is off the top of the dome, too. Yeah, there's no notes.
There's no notes. January 25th, and then Being Mary Jane.
June 25th. You mean.
June 25th, yes, yeah, June 25th. Being Mary Jane is on now, and it's coming back later
on. That's Gabby Union, right?
Gabby Union,
your buddy right there.
Absolutely, killing it right there. making that happen. It's a hot season this year. She moved to New York for Being Mary Jane. So make sure you check that out. Tuesdays at 10 on BET. So there's a lot going on. Me and the team, we got this cooking.
Feel like as if like Being Mary Jane's a hit show? You know, like I guess they don't get recognized like at these other award shows. Is that ever a concern?
Because. And this is going to sound corny, but it's true. Love to get awards. Everybody loves to get awards. But I love when people are engaged on social media. Mm. Like, I love when I can go to Twitter and people are talking about, ooh, I can't believe she did that. Or, is she really going to have a boyfriend? And people are acting as like, are responding as if these are people in their own lives. Mm. Because that's really what we aim for. I'm not going to lie. Like, I would love for us to get awards, Emmys, whatever it is. But fortunately, like every week we get our award when we find out how our audience responds. I learned that when I worked with Tom Joyner for a year, and that's where I learned like the audience is the thing. Everything else is cool, but like focus on what the audience wants. Focus on the audience wants, and you'll never go wrong.
Mm. Sounds good.
Delivering what the people want, Stephen.
Yes,
man.
Sir.
Congratulations, brother.
Dude, thank you very much.
What do we miss, Stephen? Anything else?
No,
man?
No,
you're the
no,
boss, baby.
This has been. Look. I have much respect for what you are in the culture and how you are able to have people kind of dissect it. Like when you had Dave Free up here, I was like, "What?
Yeah, you know how hard that was to make happen,
man.
Put a lot of work in for that, Steven. Yeah. You understand how that works?
Well, yeah. Him, you know, on one end, it's and I mean this just in terms of the kind of you have Dave Free and you have Lior, both of them. So incredibly important to the culture.
Right.
Both of them so incredibly reticent about doing interviews or being kind of more freeform conversation.
Yeah.
But the way y'all approach it, I love that you can get out of your guests what you do.
Are you encouraged that the audience kind of really wants to know everybody behind the scenes and they want more insight? Like you were a kid that read the credits, and it seems like now we have fans who get new generation. They want to know. They want to know who Brooke Payne is. They want to know who Stephen Hill is.
I think that's new in the last 10 years. Mm-hmm. I think you're right. There are more people who, you know, where I found out I was like the only person doing it in my generation. There's a lot more people who because of the access to information and the ability to find things out by just like typing in the top of your bar knowing what you want to know. I love that people want to know that. I hope they take that knowledge and turn it into something positive for themselves. Mm. Right? The fact that they can see that Dave Free can run a whole empire. The fact that Dave Free, like, he doesn't need about a bunch of people around. He just needs a few really loyal folks to move the way they need to move. Yeah. Right? I hope they learn from that and make positive moves for themselves.
Right.
Cool.
So we're going to get that Friday time slot for Rap Radar podcast on BET.
There it is.
I'll take a nice 11 to 12.
You got the cameras going. I see how this works.
I want that free AM slot, man. I want to go to Uncut, man. I'll take free AM. I'll start from the bottom. Let's do it.
Yo, some of the language I've heard y'all use around here, y'all need 3 o'clock. I ain't that dude, but I heard some of them.
All right, Stephen. Thank you, sir. Congratulations,
thank you.
Stephen Hill, man.
Rap Radar podcast.
Yeah.